Welcome to African and African American Folktales. My name is Donna Washington, and I'm a storyteller. Today I'm going to tell you three traditional folktales. One comes from the United States, and two come from Africa. Stories have been an important part of African life for thousands of years. Even today, troops of entertainers travel from village to village to present programs of music, dancing, and stories. Often their stories are told in song and dance. Sometimes the entertainers' programs can last for several days. In the beginning, African tales weren't written down. They were passed from one generation to the next by word of mouth. People who could remember stories and tell them well were highly regarded throughout Africa, and they still are. African folk tales are used to pass on important ideas, tribal rules, and religious beliefs. Now, Africans aren't the only people who have folk tales. Every country in the world has a folk history. People tell folk tales for many different reasons. Some stories try to explain things about the world. You may have read or heard stories that answer the question, why do leopards have spots? Or how come elephants have trunks? My first tale offers an explanation about where stories come from. It's called How Anansi Obtained the Sky God's Stories. Long ago, the sky god Niami was keeper of all the stories. Many came to ask for the stories, but Niami thought none worthy enough to bring them to Earth. One day, Anansi the spider climbed on his thread to the skies in order to ask for the stories. How can you, Anansi, hope to be worthy enough to bring my stories to Earth?
All I ask is for a chance.
Very well. If you bring me Momboro the hornet, Onini the snake, and Osibo the leopard, the stories will be yours.
Anansi thought for several minutes and then agreed. Okay. He dropped back to Earth on his thread, and there he set a plan into action. Momboro, it's raining. Come into my gourd, where you will be nice and dry.
Why, thank you, friend Anansi.
After Momboro was captured, Anansi took him to Niami. My eyes have seen Momboro. You have done well, Anansi. Now return.
And so Anansi went back to Earth, where he set the second part of his plan into action. What a coincidence you should happen by, Onini. Why, just this morning I was having an argument with my wife. I said you were longer than this stick, and she said you were not. Would you help me prove that I am right?
Why, of course, friend Anansi.
If you would stretch out next to the stick and let me tie you to it, I would be able to prove that I am right.
Oh,
I can see that I am much longer than that stick. Yes, of course you may tie me to it.
Once Anansi had tightly spun a web around Onini and the stick, he took the snake to Niami, far up in the sky. My eyes have seen Onini. You have done well, Anansi. Now, return.
And so Anansi went back to Earth, where he set the final part of his plan into action.
Ah! Friend Anansi! As you can see, I've fallen into this hole. Can you think of a way to get me out?
Yes, I have an idea. There's a springy tree over here. I'll bend it down to you so you can tie your tail to it. Then I'll let you up very slowly.
Thank you, friend Anansi. I will forever be in your debt.
Well, Anansi watched carefully as Osibo tied his tail to the end of the tree. But then, instead of letting the tree up slowly, he let go all at once and hopped on the leopard's tail. Osibo, Anansi riding on his tail, went flying up to Nayami. When the sky god saw Osibo, he knew he must fulfill his promise to the spider. I will now give you all my stories. But, being a fun-loving god, Nayami decided to play a trick on Anansi. He stuffed all his stories in a bag too small to hold them and placed a thorny bush where Anansi would drop from the sky. And sure enough, just as Nayami had planned, a thorn poked through the bag and the stories flew out. They landed everywhere, on earth, on the water, the trees, the grasses, and the people. And that is where we still find them today. Everywhere. Stories in people, places, and things. Stories from which we can learn and enjoy. Anansi is a very popular trickster character in West African folklore. He appears in many stories as a spider, as he did in the one you just heard. Tricksters are characters who are very clever. They use their wits to help solve problems. They also play a lot of tricks on people or animals in the stories in which they appear. Tricksters are found in folktales around the world. The Irish have leprechauns, Native Americans have trickster coyotes, Northern Europeans have elves and pixies, and I'm sure you can think of quite a few others. Magical events have always been an important part of folktales, and so these stories stretch our imaginations. They also can tell us things about people who live in faraway places. The next story does both. As you watch and listen, see if you can remember how the people in the story earn their living. See if you can find out anything about the foods they eat, the houses they live in, and who their leaders are. But most of all, just sit back and enjoy this magical, funny tale. It's called Talk. One day, a farmer went out to his yam patch to get some yams to sell at market. When he got there, he began to dig for the biggest, juiciest yam he could find. All of a sudden, he heard a voice say, "You don't come see me during the rainy season, and I almost drown. You don't come see me during the dry season, and I almost die of thirst. And you don't come see me when all the weeds grow, and I almost strangle to death. And now, no thanks to you, I've gotten big and juicy. You come here with your digging stick to dig me up and sell me at the marketplace. Well, you can just leave me alone." The man was very surprised. He looked over at his cow, who was quietly chewing its cud. "Did you say something?" His cow didn't answer, but his dog did.
"Well, no. The cow didn't say anything. The yam did. He said to leave him alone. And I think he was right."
The man was shocked. His dog had never spoken to him before. And besides that, he didn't like his tone of voice. So he walked to the nearest tree and grabbed a branch to switch the dog. As soon as he did, the tree said,
"Hey, put that down."
The man was so shocked, he began to throw the branch on the ground. Just then, the branch said,
"Oh, put me down gently."
The man got very frightened. Even so, he followed the branch's directions and gently laid the limb on a rock. And the rock said,
"Hey, get that off my back!"
Well, that was just too much for the man.
"Oh!"
And he ran towards the village.
"Oh!"
He hadn't gone too far when he came across a fisherman with a fish trap on his head. And the fisherman said,
"Hey, friend, you're going to knock somebody over running like that."
"Oh, I'm frightened. I have to get back to the village. Everything started talking to me. The yam said, leave me alone. The dog said, listen to what the yam said. The tree said, put that down. The limb said, put me down gently. And the rock said, get that off my back."
That is the most foolish story I've ever heard. Do you honestly expect me to believe that? And the fish trap on top of the fisherman's head said,
I want to know just one thing. Did you take the limb off the rock's back or didn't you?
The fisherman hurled away the trap and along with the farmer ran towards the village. Soon they came upon a tailor carrying a bolt of cloth.
Where are you running like that? Don't you know it's dangerous to run so fast? You might knock somebody over.
Oh, we have to get back to the village. Everything started to talk to me today. The yam said, leave me alone. The dog said, listen to what the yam said. The tree said, put that down. The limb said, put me down gently. And the rock said, get that off my back. And my fish trap said, well, did he? Is that anything to be running about?
Well, if that happened to you, you'd run, too.
And the three of them began running towards the village. After several moments, they arrived to find the chief sitting on a stool in front of his house.
Now there, quiet down. What seems to be the matter?
Oh, this has been the strangest day. Everything has been talking. The yam said, leave me alone. The dog said, listen to what the yam said. The tree said, put that down. The limb said, put me down gently. The rock said, get that off my back. The fish trap said, did you? And the bolt of cloth said, you run too.
I want you three to return to work, and I don't want to hear any more of this foolishness.
The men tried to protest, but the chief interrupted them.
If you say anything else, I will banish you from the village.
It's people like that who cause trouble in a village.
I couldn't agree more. Who ever heard of a talking yam?
Well now, let's see if you can name some important foods of Africa. Foods suggested by the story. Okay, yams or sweet potatoes. What about fish? Don't forget the fishermen in the story. There's also milk and cheese. Those foods would come from the cow. Now, what did the story tell us about how some Africans earn their living? Well, there are farmers, fishermen, and those who make and sell cloth. Of course, Africans work at many other jobs, too. It depends on where they live. In cities, there are doctors and lawyers and teachers and cab drivers and so on, just like here. Did you notice the houses in the village? In West Africa, they're often made of mud and thatch, just like those you saw in the story. And the leader in the village is often a chief, the person who makes certain that tribal rules and laws are obeyed. Many of the main characters in the talk folk tale are objects, yams, trees, rocks, and so forth. But there are still plenty of people. In many folk tales, however, there are no people at all, and it's up to the animals or the things in the story to do all the talking. My last story features two talking animals, a fox and a rabbit. It's one of the more than 300 Brer Rabbit stories found in the African-American folktale tradition. Brer Rabbit tales were very popular among African-Americans during slavery days. Slaves liked the smart little rabbit who could use his brain power to outwit those who were supposed to be more powerful. It helped them remember that a person's body might be enslaved, but not his or her mind. The story is called Brer Fox and Doc Rabbit Build a House. One day, Doc Rabbit and Brer Fox was busy building a house. As the hours passed, it became hotter and hotter. Doc Rabbit began to think how nice it would be to have a drink of that sweet cream he and Brer Fox had put in the cool water for when they had finished building the house. So he went to where Brer Fox couldn't see him, and he started moaning. That got Brer Fox to a wondering. Doc Rabbit? Did you hear that moaning? Sounds like someone's in a heap of pain.
Yep, I heard it all right.
Well, you better go see who it is, you being the only doctor in these here parts.
Nope, I ain't gonna do it. I promised to help you make this here house, and that's what I'm gonna do.
But Brer Fox kept saying how it was Doc Rabbit's duty to help sick folks. So Doc Rabbit left the house, sneaked down to the stream, and took himself a big, long drink of that sweet cream. Drank just about half of it. Then he hopped back to the house.
Who was it? Oh, it wasn't nobody. Just the wind and the trees.
And they went back to work. But before too long, it started getting hotter and hotter and hotter. And Doc Rabbit started thinking about that sweet cream again. So he went to where Brown Fox couldn't see him and started groaning. Oh.
Doc Rabbit, do you hear that? That ain't no wind in the trees. I'm sure that's somebody calling you. You're right, Brown Fox. That does sound like somebody a calling. But I ain't gonna go see who it is. No, sirree. I'm gonna stay right here and help you finish making this house. No. You got to go. Seeing how you is the only doctor in these here parts, it's your duty.
So Doc Rabbit left the house, went down to the stream, and drank the rest of that sweet cream, then ran into the forest. Well, Brer Fox was a-working away and getting pretty hot himself, so he decided to take just a little sip of that sweet cream. So he went off to the stream. Well, as soon as he saw that that cream was gone, he figured out what had happened, and he was mad. He decided he was gonna punish Doc Rabbit for tricking him like that. So he made a baby out of tar, with ears like a rabbit's. Then he sat that tar baby down where he knew Doc Rabbit would be hopping by. Sure enough, later that day, Doc Rabbit was hopping down the path and saw that tar baby sitting there just as quiet as you please. Now Doc Rabbit, thinking to be sociable, said, "Howdy!" But the tar baby, he didn't say nothing. Too stuck up.
Can't you say nothing? Where's your manners? I said, "Howdy!" Now you listen here. Either you say howdy back, or I'm gonna haul off and hit you in your nose. Now, howdy!
But the tar baby, he didn't say nothing. So Doc Rabbit pulled his arm back and popped it right in the tar. Well, his arm got stuck right up to the elbow.
Now, you give me my arm back, or I'll hit you with my other arm.
But the tar baby just sat there. So Doc Rabbit hauled off and smacked him again. And his other arm got stuck up to the elbow. Well, Doc Rabbit realized now that he was in a lot of trouble. He started squirming and moving and wrestling, trying to get loose. But the more he struggled, the more stuck he got. In just a little while, all you could see was his eyeballs. And a little while after that, Brer Fox, walking through the forest, came upon Doc Rabbit, all wrapped up in that gooey glob of tar.
"Well, Doc Rabbit, looks like I got you good this time, and I'm gonna teach you a lesson about tricking folks."
So Brer Fox cleaned Doc Rabbit up and said,
"Now I'm gonna throw you in the fire, ha ha! You go on and throw me in the fire if you like, Brer Fox, but whatever you do, please, oh please don't fling me in the briar patch!"
Well, Brer Fox looked over and saw that briar patch with them sticky, sticky thorns everywhere. Looked like Doc Rabbit would be cut real good if he threw him that there briar patch.
"Ha! Fire's too good for you, Doc Rabbit. I'm gonna fling you in that there briar patch."
And that's just what he did. Then he waited to hear Doc Rabbit screaming. But he didn't hear nary a sound. Then he looked and he saw Doc Rabbit just a-dancing and singing.
"Ha ha! Hey, Brer Fox! How's y'all doing? I'm doing fine! I was born and bred in this here briar patch, and this is exactly where I wanted to be."
I hope you liked that Brer Rabbit folktale, as well as the other stories in this program. If you did, you'll be pleased to know that your school and community libraries probably have dozens of African and African American folktale collections on their bookshelves. So why not stop by and check out several of them? They'll give you many hours of enjoyment. Thank you very much for allowing me to share my stories with you. I'm Donna Washington.
Mañana zapata, yeah. It's a one. wanita biasa. Asa yung muna na mafnata, suwang fanya na ramah.